of thoughts and fantasy. And then I set the limit with the ways of how I feel. I've been conformed by a school and just like you. But I know better, 'cause I searched and found the truth.
Hello there. While I'm eating and while the show snow is being shoveled outside, I wonder if you can hear the noise. I guess we'll know once I check the video. So on the note of eating, I'm having my breakfast. Since a couple of months, I don't actually eat breakfast anymore much. I do the intermittent fasting idea until the afternoon or until the evening. For a whole month I did it until the evening, until dinner. But now it's turning into that I'm very often eating a little something in the late afternoon, like around 5 or so. I'm into sprouts. Sprouts. This one is purple, this one is green. I'm in the black and white winter world, and they taste like radishes, very mild radishes. It's a live food, it grows similarly to the pea sprouts. So beautiful. Even black and white, they're still beautiful. Sprouts from Wonderland, I call them. But what I want to share is that I noticed that after Christmas and New Year's, where I went to Denmark, and I never celebrate those things and haven't done that since since my grandma died. I used to do it with her. So then I allowed myself to totally indulge. I didn't eat any meat and all that, but I indulged in all the sweets and the sauce and the whatever. And when I came back in the beginning of January, I felt so heavy. I even gained weight. I felt horrible. I felt physically just heavy, and I would have again the stuff that I just had gotten rid of, more or less, pretty much, not completely, where I wake up and it takes me 2 hours before I start feeling like a, before I get out of feeling like a sore sack of cement, or I don't know. But this came back and really severe, and with this heaviness, I just felt drawn to basically again eating even more healthy. So I got my food then simplified and for a whole month, and I'm still eating like that actually, but it took a month to feel the difference. And so for a whole month I was just basically every evening eating only raw rucola, these long funny rucola leaves raw with sliced what do you call it? The not the round red peppers, but the long one, because the long one is the natural one. That's the non-hybrid one. And rucola is non-hybrid. And the chef would add to it, funny enough, something so typical, in the German kitchen. What's it called? I always want to call it anise. No. What's it called? Okay, I don't know what it's called in English, actually. It's called Fenchel. So I'm gonna have to look that up and basically write the translation here below in the video. And which tastes amazing when it's raw, but when you cook with it, I don't like it. He meant during the day, I was, you know, like a drug addicted person, still having my cigarettes and coffee, but I would keep it to one coffee at least. Let's not get into the whole cigarette thing these days. And then after about a month, I went to Munich. And as I was there meeting people and going about and being asked the question, how are you? I for the first time in my life, found myself just spitting out without thinking about it. I feel great. I feel amazing. And then I would feel like, oh my God, wow, what is this? Wow, I need to explain why. And then I would notice how my energy was and how I feel physically and how my mind was getting clear. And wow, so feeling sick and weighed down and physically like really fracked up and all this sore and heavy and this went away by simply eating very simple, very light and raw. So I'm amazed in the difference of how I ended up feeling. I'm amazed. So now I'm breaking the thing a little bit because I feel better still. So now sometimes I'll have like a spelt bread, sourdough spelt bread. So that's also non-hybrid. It's called ancient corn also. With sprouts and cashewy thing that looks and tastes like cheese. And there's very few ingredients in it, so even though it's processed, it's wow, I'm impressed. It's brilliant. So, but yeah, let food be thy medicine, let medicine be thy food. It definitely works. Wow, I'm so impressed. Anyway, so I was feeling physically like a sore sack of shit, taking 2 hours to get out of the bed, waking up so as if paralyzed from a, like a paralyzing kind of soreness. Paralyzing is totally exaggerated, I know. Basically feeling physically unable to really get out of the bed, feeling so heavy and so sore that I would have to like sort of, yeah, spend an hour or two, usually two, to sort of slowly wake up, and by slowly gaining this average normal consciousness sort of thing, I would also slowly feel physically a bit more capable to get up, but absolutely horrific feeling. And so just because I am a health freak anyhow, not like other people, I never was really extremist or anything, but I felt so more and more drawn to something that is in the end than actually the extreme. But what I'm just, you know, my focus, my intention and focus of food was basically just the rucola and the red pepper. The red pepper, paprika, whatever. In the beginning, I was putting balsamic on it to you know, give the liver kidneys system a bit of a break from fat things. And then eventually I realized that, wow, I don't even need I don't need any herb mixture on it, and I don't need the balsamic on it either. I just started eating it like that with my fingers, and it's just, wow, what a pleasure. I can't explain it. It's like I feel like I'm laying in the field surrounded by rucola and stuff, and I'm just eating it directly from nature. It feels amazing. And so, yeah, after about a month of doing that, my whatever physical pain, illness, heaviness is gone. I feel much more clear-headed. I feel amazing. Wow. And then there's something I want to add to that. And then, because I have, like, friends that... I have friends that smoke joints. And I became a joint smoker, like, permanently... from basically every evening of every day after I had a car accident, and some 6-7 months after that I was still having, from this huge shock, I was having anxiety and panic attack feeling inside. And when a security guy invited me to have a few puffs of his joint one evening, then I was so blown away by how I just feel like all that from residue from the car accident, from the shock, that it's gone. I feel so like me. I just feel normal now. And so after that, I thought, okay, here we go. This is the cure. And before that, I would have, you know, the best of stuff to smoke in my house, and I would never touch it. It would just be in a nice little historic looking wooden box. I'd call it the magic box, and that box was just there for when I would have friends visiting for dinner or something who I know smoked, then I would offer them the magic box here. But it wasn't something I touched myself, you know. I had stuff in there for over a year until someone came by and tried to smoke it and said, "Hey man, this is too old." So, and suddenly, I you know, and so since that, it has been over 10 years. And so since that, I just am noticing that whenever I go and spend, say, a week's time with smokers, then I smoke for the whole week's time too. And then some of the heaviness and mind fog and really energetic low and being incapable and not having capacity, all of that comes back. And then it takes about 2 to 3 weeks to make it go away. Sometimes it can take longer depending how long you've smoked every day. So that's interesting. I find that interesting. I find that something that I would point out for people to know. That shit is actually wearing you out. So at least, you know, if you smoke a few puffs every evening, maybe not. But if you are one of those people who is so used to smoking that you make a joint and then later you make another one, and maybe even another one, and you can just smoke that like, oh, it's nothing. That's serious weighing down shit. It seems, it feels to me that it goes on the liver, kidney, either both or one of them or whatever. It's doing something toxic in my body. And I'm a cigarette smoker, so I can tell you my cigarettes do not do that. My cigarettes do not do that. That's yeah, it's weird. It's an interesting thing that I don't find any information about online. I don't have never found anyone talking about it or anyone who has any clue about it. So on the note of eating healthy, definitely, absolutely, there's no doubt about that, that food is thy medicine. Basically, whatever we may inhale and whatever we may drink or otherwise eat, that's the medicine. That's what's causing the problems, aside psychological things like a trauma, like a shock, like a whatever happened when you were too little to process things. That's all part of it. That's all those kinds of things that are all part of it. But still, I experience that if I eat in a way like I'm doing now, then I become so healthy, I start becoming so healthy, I start becoming so energetic, I start becoming so good feeling whole, that even an anxiety or, okay, no, I don't have that really anymore, but whatever old stuff that sits in me, I'm so suddenly able to rise above it. Actually, simple as that. That is for sure also partly because I'm very, I tend to be very self-objective and analytical and stuff. And so, of course, I also pay attention to how I then will think and make some decisions differently or get carried away with a certain feeling in a certain moment of, for example, a social setting or something that happens unexpectedly. And then I very quickly, because I'm used to it, I very quickly can identify what's happening in me and where it's coming from and that this is not necessary and that it all, you know, if it's not pleasant, calming feelings, then or excited, joyful feelings, well, then they're obviously feelings that have their roots in different types of fears of all sorts, big and small. And so I think that's part of why I then, when I just become healthy, I'm able to, as if, like, this rise above my traumas and issues. And so yeah, health is definitely number one. And now that we live in these awakening times, I also feel like I want to share what I know since a long time already, that exactly this, you know, health is the key to your awakening. Also, if you're in perfect health, which apparently that's what masonry is about originally, it's about learning and understanding how to actually live so that you're healthy. Because when you're healthy, then you are not disconnected, you're not clogged up in your physical body, so you're healthy, so you're sharp, so you're clear, so you're, you know, so you're more high on life, you could say, even. And that's where you then start, that's where you then are connected directly to the non-physical, which is then, you know, there is all the knowledge, there is all the, if you learn how to work with it, then that's where all the sort of supernatural things come from. And so it's nothing abnormal at all. It's just that we are raised to be lacking knowledge and to be ignorant and to be powerless and to believe that we are little powerless creeps kind of thing. And we're not. We're divine beings, actually. We're just kept under this crazy illusion through basically just keeping us, you know, in fear and insecure and most of all unhealthy. The unhealthy is like, wow, if something can make you weak and dumb and all of whatever shit you name it, then it's, you know, to have you fooled about the things that you eat and drink and feed your mind with, you know. That's really the key. And so that's what masonry apparently originally is all about. Interesting, huh? So yeah, we need to get healthy, get light. It is a time of where the just energies, natural energies have it in them for us to really feel like we do not want to eat that much and we do not want to eat animal produce and fat things and all the, it's all wearing us down and alcohol more than once a week is just, oh, it's just, and even once a week for me is like, what? So I want people to know this. I want people to hear this. I want people to become aware, at least to become inspired to consider and contemplate this and maybe look into it, you know, and get enlightened. And that might be really motivating. That might really help to manage to eat that simple and actually make it really easy. And, you know, the faster that we can have everybody to wake up, as many people as possible, the faster we can do that, the less of disasters and horrible things we have to go through, actually. Because I can't even, let's not get into why, but that's just, it's kind of, I think to a lot of us that's logic, you know. So yeah, it's very important, food, wow, it's so important what we put in as well. Of course, my choice of this way of eating is comes out of some knowledge that I have. So I noticed that the more in-depth knowledge that you have about something, the more that changes your awareness of it. And when it changes the awareness of something, then it starts to change the feeling of something. And so when it comes to food and what we drink, then eventually it starts to even have an effect on the way that you're experiencing tasting it. So on its taste, you know, on the experience of eating it, it's that the taste starts to change. I suddenly became like a rucola addict. I can just put rucola on anything or make a bit of rucola on the plate and then put the food on top of it. You know, if you cook me veggie tomato sauce with some spelt pasta, perhaps, I want it on a bed of rucola. When the shopping and making the food is in my own hands, I just stick to what I just stick to that one. But now I've learned that both rucola and this type of red, long pointy pepper fruit, paprika, that actually they are also non-hybrid foods. So that's sort of like, you know, that just make them sparkle and shine a whole lot more in my vision and feeling and experience. And so that's really what became the final sort of drop in my glass to overflow with goodness and amazement for me to actually use that as my way of eating for betterment, eating for cure, if you will. Now that since it works so well and fast, I would say. I mean, within a month's time, you know, a few weeks, less than a month, that's fast in my opinion. You know, just using food. So now if I would quit smoking cigarettes and stop drinking coffee, even though my coffee is like a pretty good quality coffee, it's fresh, it's not old stale coffee that was roasted last year or anything like that. But if I was to stop, let's say, yeah, just the smoking, you know, what kick that might do to my health and energy. So so I'm awaiting to wake up soon with this overwhelming feeling need to quit smoking, because that has happened to me before some years ago. I was so full of it. But what really helped me was that my sister friend urgently needed to quit smoking. Right around that time that I was getting so filled with wanting to stop smoking, that basically she had to, because she had some operations coming up, getting a piece of artificial skull, and the body wouldn't accept it, and it wouldn't accept it, and suddenly I found out that I noticed being there around the third operation, I think getting ready for the fourth one, something like that. I noticed that she was lying to the doctor. There was something I noticed which made me think, wait a minute, so that means, wait a minute, no. And so I confronted her at some point in privacy and was like, hey, have you actually been lying to the doctor? Like, saying that you quit smoking, but you actually didn't? And then she was like, you know, first reaction was to like start rejecting self-defense style, you know. But yeah, but then she was like, oh, she admitted. And I was like, you're crazy. That is why your body is not accepting the foreign peace. And she was devastated that the operations weren't working out and that she had to go through this horrible thing that I'm not going to get into describing now to prepare for the next one. It's basically, just to mention briefly, it's basically a process of growing slowly more and more skin to have enough skin to do the operation, because every time you do the operation, you cut away skin, right? And so she was like feeling like it's the end of her and she's never gonna get well and her body is never gonna. And I'm like, well, you idiot, man, you are causing it yourself. You have to stop smoking. And so I was like, look, I'm gonna come up to you for 3 weeks and, you know, we're gonna spend the first days enjoying our company and smoking, and then we're gonna go to bed and not smoke for the 8 hours that we sleep, and then we wake up and just don't ever smoke again. And so I'm gonna do that with you for 3 weeks and then that's it, you know, and you'll be fine. I know it. And so I did that and it worked. Okay, she didn't quit while I was there. She just started smoking out of the terrace door and stuff to respect that I wasn't smoking. But it motivated me so much that I remained to be that good example for her. And so that made me quit smoking. Then I fell into it after 3 months when I started forgetting to take my niacin tablets, which is a vitamin B3 that is pretty much identical to nicotine, but it's a vitamin, not nicotine. I started forgetting to take that into the third month, and I felt like everything was so easy. It was the easiest thing to quit smoking. So I didn't consider it to be really important or relevant, and so I didn't make an effort to remember to take my vitamin B3, my niacin tablet, and so the feeling to have a cigarette grew eventually, and yeah, it got me completely seduced and fooled, and it was as if I had some fucking amnesia, and I suddenly acted as if I didn't know that as a smoker, when you quit, if you just smoke one cigarette, that means you're a smoker again. And I know that. But you can get so seduced in this way. Wow. So yeah, that's that. Now you got this story also of how it can be to quit smoking. So I'm sort of waiting that this kind of days come again where I start accumulating all these feeling reasons inside me for wanting to quit smoking, and then something appears that sort of puts the drop in my glass and smoke is gone. And this time I will not fall for the one cigarette shit. Don't be scared of anything in life. Fear is false evidence appearing real. It's bullshit. If something makes you instantly start becoming stupid, then it's fear. Bye for now.